Good day, and welcome to day two of the 2021 Permanent and Private Capital Summit and our panel titled DE&I and ESG as the World Turns. It sounds like a daytime drama, but I guarantee it'll be more interesting than any daytime drama you have watched. Given all that is going on, not only in the U.S., but throughout the world, diversity, equity, and inclusion, and environmental, social, and corporate governance have increasingly become critical components across all business sectors, but also in the world of asset managers. Today, we've been able to pull together four dynamite panelists with diverse perspectives that you're going to hear from. They will consider best practices and policies from the U.S. and transatlantic perspectives against the backdrop of evolving regulatory and enforcement concerns. Let's get started. Let me introduce you to our first panelist. Jennifer Ishiguro serves as Chief Legal Officer and Secretary of StepStone Group Incorporated, a global private markets investment firm with approximately $333 billion, with a B, of total private markets allocations, including $80 billion of assets under management as of December 31st, 2020, and offices in 19 cities across North and South America, Europe, and Asia. StepStone's clients include some of the world's largest public and private defined benefit and defined contribution pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, and insurance companies, as well as prominent endowments, foundations, family offices, and private wealth clients. She is a member of the firm's Diversity and Inclusion Committee and Responsible Investments Committee. Thank you for being with us today, Jennifer. Next, we have Greg Nixon, who is the Head of Strategic Investments for Cerberus. In his role, he focuses on investment opportunities with the potential to drive technological, security, and defense advancements across sectors and geographies. For over a decade, Mr. Nixon has partnered with Cerberus and its affiliates across a diverse array of projects and investments. He has been a Managing Director with Cerberus' industry-leading operations team, Cerberus Operations and Advisory Company, and has served on the board of directors for several Cerberus portfolio companies, including most recently Navistar Defense, where he's Chairman, and Spartan Corporation. We also have Ana Carolina Oliveira, who heads ING's sustainable finance team covering the Americas region. She works with ING's clients in providing structuring and advisory of sustainable finance solutions to support them in accelerating their sustainability transition. Ana Carolina also plays an integral role in supporting ING's Terra approach, a commitment to steer its $600 billion lending book in line with the goals of the Paris Agreement to keep global warming to well below 2 degrees. Ana Carolina also represents ING in supporting industry discussions as a member of the executive committee of the International Capital Markets Association and sustainable finance-related working groups. She has extensive experience in advising clients on capital structure and working capital optimization, and previously has served as a director in ING's healthcare sector group, where she covered U.S. large multinationals and was one of the founders of ING Global Healthcare Platform. Last but not least, Dechert's very own Mikhaelle Schiappacasse is a partner in Dechert's funds group based in London. Her practice focuses on the structuring, establishment, management, marketing, and restructuring of fund platforms and investment funds, including hedge, debt, real estate, private equity, and funds of funds across a broad range of asset classes and fund domiciles. She also advises on the establishment of asset management businesses, including the drafting and negotiation of shareholder agreements and limited liability partnership agreements. She also acts for investment funds and their managers on general corporate, regulatory, and compliance matters, and Dechert is very, very honored to have her on Dechert's global ESG working group. Without further ado, let's jump right into the first question. ESG investing is often perceived as values-based investing rather than investing to maximize return. The first question for the group is that a fair evaluation of the role of ESG in investing, And do you think that the increased global focus on ESG is having a fundamental impact on firms' investment processes? Let's start with Anna Carolina, because let's have you kick it off, because I understand that you have some data pulled together that may help frame our discussion on this point.
Sure. Thank you, Vincent, and thank you very much for having me. It's really a privilege to be part of the discussion today. So at ING, we really think a sustainable business is better business. And we say that not as a jargon, because it's very simple. Companies that are managed more efficiently and embedding ESG goals and their long-term targets, that has an implication in their financial performance. We really believe that's a very simple equation, and that also expands the numbers of investors potentially interested to join the capital structure of such companies. So speaking of investors, there are more than 2,500 investors nowadays that have signed up to the UN PRI, and you're looking at 120 trillion of assets under management. So absolutely became more than mainstream, I would say. And on that spirit, we went out, ING commissioned a research or survey, I should say, with the FT to go out and talk to 450 corporates and 100 institutional investors to check the temperature, what happened when it comes to ESG priority due to, especially with the pandemic. And some numbers are quite stark, and not surprisingly, but the magnitude of the responses were really impressive. So first of all, both companies and investors all have said that with the pandemic, that has, if anything, accelerated their plans and their actions when it comes to incorporating ESG into their portfolios or into their agendas. 74% of the investors have said they will increase their commitments looking at their portfolios when it comes to alignment with ESG goals, more specifically the Paris Climate Agreement. So climate stays top of mind. But interestingly, and that came very strongly, especially from America's investors, is the increased emphasis into social issues. I think with anything, the silver lining to a pandemic, if there is one, is that everybody is aware and recognize the need of bringing the S of ESG much more into the forefront. So areas like incorporating diversity, equity, and inclusion definitely are much more a part of investors' agenda. I think a last point I would like to mention there, ESG integration is considered by most of those surveyed one of the most effective approaches when it comes to changing corporate's behavior. So that's something that doesn't seem to be changing anytime soon. So I think the good news from our standpoint is not a choice between profitability, sustainability. Things are pretty much the same page and go hand in hand in that regard.
Great. Thank you for that. I know, Mikhaelle, I know you have some interesting non-U.S. perspectives to add to this question. Why don't you share those with us if you could?
Thanks, Vince. Yeah, I mean, if you take a look at this from the European perspective, here the changes are really being driven at this point in time by regulation. So the EU has published a number of regulations that require managers to actually change their policies and their connected procedures in connection with certain disclosure and reporting obligations that are now being imposed on them, and also certain requirements around looking at environmental, social, or governance risks when they are making their risk management decisions or indeed looking at their conflicts of interest in a particular transaction. So these regulatory changes are really driving things in Europe. And because of these changes at sort of the asset management level, and also at the banking level and in the insurance level and the pension plan level, it impacts on all these different financial market participants. Institutional investors within the European market are changing their attention and focusing more on making green investments. And I would say maybe a little bit different from what Anna Carolina said, the focus is really on the environmental side and climate change and alignment with the Paris Agreement and trying to keep the global warming below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. So the focus now with institutional investors means that firms that manage assets in the European space or for European clients are finding that they have to move out of pure ESG integration, and in fact, away even from exclusionary investing and into inclusionary investing or impact investing in order to attract that particular source of capital. The other thing, and I just want to touch on this very briefly, is that it's not just a European issue. If you're a global asset management firm, say you're a US investment advisor who's managing a European product on a delegated basis, you need to keep in mind that your portfolio management team, who might also be managing a US investment, can't split their, you know, the way they manage a strategy and manage the European strategy one way and the US focused strategy a different way. And so those requirements that then apply to their activities in Europe are going to trickle into the way they do things for their US based clients. And they're going to have to then consider whether those regulatory requirements align with the expectations of the US regulators in the way they manage their investments and interact with their clients.
Let's discuss the key changes in the way the issues of DE&I are discussed and approached over the past couple years within the industry. Is there anything that you think firms aren't talking about that they should be? And how can companies overcome common challenges associated with measuring and reporting on DE&I, for example, in order to demonstrate continued progress? Jennifer, why don't we start with you?
Thanks, Vince. I think that DEI is really a journey. It's not a destination. And I think firms are moving past just looking at the numbers for recruiting, promotions, and retention of their diverse team members, but really looking at how do we move to inclusion, actual influence, how does diversity flow into decision-making and corporate culture? And these are much harder to measure. So for example, are diverse people contributing to a culture of inclusiveness? Are they being listened to, particularly in decision-making? Are there senior leaders coming from diverse backgrounds? Do they wield sufficient power and influence within the institution, or are decisions made by just two or three people at the top? Another way to look at it is decision-making push the right levels in order to empower and engage a broader set of leadership? And do leaders seek to listen to the voice of other people throughout the organization, whether on one-on-one or through focus groups or affinity groups or employee resource groups? Another metric is, do people feel safe to speak up and share their perspectives, even if they may differ from that of leadership? So these are the kinds of things that I think we need to move to, as well as the fact that as we become more and more global and interconnected, and we need to also look at diversity in a very different way, looking at diversity of backgrounds and experiences and not just looking solely at the common metrics that are looked at currently. I think also the final point I would mention is that I think in terms of legal, the way that legal leaders have been looking at ESG and D&I have really expanded, especially in the last year or so, I would say, in the wake of some of the social justice movements that have come into play. So it's a really exciting time, I would say, for many leaders within the organizations to really drive change in this respect.
Okay, great. Greg, I know you have some thoughts on this and can share specific programs that Cerberus has in place regarding this question.
Oh, thanks, Vince. 2020 has been defined by numerous events: a global pandemic, Black Lives Matters, fighting Asian hate, and now we're seeing rising anti-Semitism in the country. Companies have found themselves pressed to declare their commitments to DEI and articulate the steps they're taking to support social justice. In addition, the public's heightened expectations for companies have also dovetailed with the growing interest of investors in ESG factors, such as D&I. Cerberus, at least in our case, Cerberus is fully committed to DEI. For example, at Cerberus, we've launched the Cerberus Women's Initiative, which is a recruiting and mentorship committee, which focuses on mentorship, education, and recruiting in the larger community. Internally, we also have an internal inclusion and advancement subcommittee, which promotes inclusion and advancement for internal employees with an initial focus on programming, planning, and execution. So just to piggyback on the insightful comments Jennifer just made, I think that we have an opportunity to implement actions that can make a difference and move the needle more in the right direction over time.
Great, thank you for that, Greg. Anna, Carolina, you have some similar thoughts, I think, to Jennifer on this issue. Would you care to share those?
Yeah, but very quickly, I think, as Jennifer mentioned, the point is not about the quantities, it's really quality, and the word used is materiality. I think what all investors and the wider financial community is after is to demonstrate that whatever metrics are being chosen or targets that are being set, they are adding to and they are consistently gradually improving. I think challenge remains as everybody acknowledges the E, or as Mikhaelle mentioned earlier, the environmental side kind of ran with it, and now there's a bit of a catch up to be played with the social parts, and there are not as many benchmarks or tools available for the measurement of impact when it comes to social topics. So a much more nuanced area for sure. So these are evolving as we speak, and there are more and more attention put into it, but definitely a harder job to be done versus environmental benchmarks for sure.
And Mikhaelle, again, do you have any a non-US perspective to share in response to the question?
Yeah, I think one of the things that I've found very interesting watching this space over the last couple of years is, you know, the conversation really used to be about gender diversity. How many women are there on boards? What is the gender pay gap within any given industry? And in the last couple of years within Europe and also particularly within the UK, the conversation has started to shift, and it started to become more about ethnic backgrounds or actually socioeconomic backgrounds, which is a big difference within the UK and other European countries as well. And with that with the Black Lives Matter movement, that's sort of become even more important. It's becoming more part of the dialogue. And I think what really remains to be seen is whether or not it moves beyond dialogue into action. And that's what's going to be interesting to watch over the next couple of years. There's a bit of a handicap within the European market in terms of data collection and tracking of diversity metrics, because it's very difficult to collect and hold, store, and use that data due to data privacy laws within Europe and the UK. And so one of the things firms are having to figure out how to do is how they can actually gather that information and look at it and see what it tells them in a meaningful way about their own internal hiring activities or their engagement externally. So hopefully that's something that we'll be engaged with more actively over the coming years. But there is definitely a visible shift in terms of the dialogue.
So some studies show that diverse workforces can drive better outcomes that enhance business growth and brand reputation. Do you have any thoughts on this? And we'll start with Jennifer.
Definitely, there are multiple studies out there that have shown that companies that have a higher percentage of women, for example, in leadership positions, do end up showing greater profitability. But it's, again, not just about the numbers, it's about how you include people into the conversation in order to drive that business growth. So as an example, I spent a number of years at Toyota Financial Services, and certainly they utilize their employee resource groups, or you may know them as affinity groups, in really gathering thoughts of people within particular affinity groups in order to help with their advertising or in order to help with making others within the organization feel included in decision-making. And so those are the types of initiatives I think that really do help drive the business, because you're utilizing your employees that both know your business extremely well, but also can understand what it takes to really capture an audience that is much broader than if you were to make a decision based on a less diverse perspective.
Great. And Anna, any thoughts to add?
Yeah, I fully agree with what Jennifer said. I think the only thing I would add there, maybe a different perspective, is besides looking at your own let's say, performance or footprint by adopting these targets for your own employees. There's also some consideration from some investors when you ask them, okay, what you would like to see happening more on the social side. And there's some of the feedback we got is that there's increasingly an expectation that you go one step further and not only stop your efforts at your own firm, but extend that towards your supply chain or your value chain, which is, it's a very important observation, given that for many corporations, a lot of the impacts might be actually when you go towards what's called scope 3 or your value chain. It's a much more challenging area, but definitely something that investors are paying attention to, and growing expectations definitely and seeing more disclosure when it comes to rolling up all those commitments from your own company towards your supply chain as well.
And to slightly expand on the question of what the benefits are of a diverse workforce, for the GCs on the panel and anyone who is responsible for sending outside work to counsel and vendors, what are your thoughts on the importance of diverse outside counsel and vendors? Greg, why don't we start with you on this one, because I know you are a champion of diversity in selecting your outside counsel. I have been a recipient of that. And in fact, you've spoken to our firm and others about the importance of having a diverse legal team representing the companies you are affiliated with. So can you share why you feel that that is so important?
Oh, sure. Thanks, Vince. Well, as you know, I've been involved with the legal community now for, 25, 26 years in some capacity. I've been a general counsel numerous times. And, just by way of observation, we've seen increased diversity or increasing diversity in the stakeholder front, the judges, the regulators, the investors. But within the legal community, we've kind of been stuck. It's gone in ebbs and flows over time. And while the intentions have been promising and there, good intentions, the mechanics of how we improve diversity within the legal profession, particularly at large law firms, has been a little bit tricky and elusive, in my view. So just some observations over the years. One, you know, I found that you really need a company commitment to increasing diversity and selecting outside counsel in a very deliberate way. And that normally starts with the general counsel. And if the general counsel is motivated and incentivized to do that, then the selection of outside counsel, diversity of outside counsel, more in line with the stakeholders that the companies or the clients are going to have to deal with, the judges, the enforcement bureaus and regulators, in some cases, the investors, that will be more in line with, the diversity picture across the portfolio. So I do think it starts with the general counsel, and the general counsel has got to be somewhat deliberate, which brings me to the next step, the next part of this, which is the executive recruiter community that placed the general counsel. That metric should be involved with their processes as well, how they're selecting, how they're thinking about it, because typically the general counsels are selected through the Rolodex of whoever the executive recruiter apparatus is, and they've got their, I don't want to say they've got a pre-played program, but they've got their Rolodex and their selected folks, and it kind of feeds on itself. With respect to benefits of diversity, I've experienced it numerous times, whether it's criminal matters, whether it's civil matters, whether it's routine corporate transactional work. The addition of different perspectives, different backgrounds, different outlooks on how to approach problems has really served at least me and my clients well over the years. And spirited debates on how to approach problems, where everybody mixes it up and gets to the right solution. So, my last point is differences are actually better as long as it's done in a constructive and productive way, you end up getting to better outcomes when you have the differences of opinion, backgrounds, experiences. Diversity really has served well in solving and approaching complex problems, which we all are going to face and will continue to face in the future.
Thank you for that. Jennifer, do you have anything to add to that question?
I agree very much with Greg, but I think we have to put our money where our mouth is. It can be really difficult in the asset management or private equity industry where certain law firms and other vendors, including law accounting firms and administrators, really carry a lot of market prominence. But it's really incumbent upon, for example, the general counsel or other people who manage other vendors, such as your CFO or your CAO, that may work very closely with your auditing firms to really have active discussions with the relationship partner or even with the firm management to really measure and track progress. And this is a piece that I think by just virtue of asking the questions on an annual basis and seeing what kind of progress the firm has had, both overall and in terms of the people who are supporting your business and your company, you can have such a direct influence over the individuals that are working on your particular account. And so having those active discussions, whether it's twice a year, once a year, when you see people that are diverse, that are up for promotion, are you really supporting them to get to that next level of partnership, for example? Are you helping to mentor those people and really help provide support? That goes beyond just paying the firm money, but really supporting people who are talented and keeping them at the firm and hopefully helping them along their journey to the next level. So having that conversation is really crucial. And when you see issues with firms that, for example, may lose a large degree of their talented, diverse associates, are you making changes to your law firm panel? Are you really holding them accountable? These are the things that can be very difficult to do, especially if you've had a longstanding relationship with a firm. But it's only when we move our dollars that oftentimes it really hits home. And so I encourage everyone to think about those things. And then the other thing is not every project, for example, needs to go to a large law firm. And so can we consider diverse owned vendors, minority and women owned law firms, for example, in the employment space or in IP space? There's a wonderful organization that you may be aware of called the National Association of Minority and Women Owned Law Firms. So I would encourage, you know, reaching out to those firms and exploring opportunities to work with those diverse counsel. It really does open up a different way of looking at things and taps into resources that you may not already have.
Great. And I know we're running close on time, so let me jump to the looking ahead question. So looking ahead to the next 10 years, what changes do you expect to see? What changes would you hope to see? I'd like to hear from each one of the panelists on this because this is kind of a catch-all and I'd be interested to get everybody's views. So why don't we start with Anna Carolina and then move down the list?
Sure. Thanks, Vince. Yeah, it's a long list of wishful thinking here. But I think for me, as we see the ESG and DE&I topics are more and more embedded into government policy, especially in Europe, is a little bit ahead there, but it's becoming more and more intrinsic element when it comes to management of stimulus packages and regulatory disclosures, etc. So for me, part of what I do on a day-to-day basis is working with companies and embedding some of those targets potentially in their capital structure, either that in forms of a bond or a loan. And for me, the desire is that this becomes so mainstream and some part of the regular way of managing a business that eventually it becomes, for example, part of a credit rating of a company, just having a very direct impact from the incorporation of the DE&I management into the company itself. So it's really becoming mainstream to a point that's becoming a known issue and doesn't need to be, you know, steered so actively as it is these days.
Great. And Mikhaelle, what are you looking forward to seeing in the next 10 years?
You know, none of my clients that I can think of operates purely within the borders of, say, the United Kingdom or any other particular jurisdiction. And yet all the regulators are starting to talk about environmental, social, and governance regulations. And what I'd like to see is that they talk to each other so that over time there's a, even if the rules themselves aren't uniform, there's some consistency to them, particularly when it comes to sort of reporting metrics, that they're looking for asset management firms or underlying portfolio companies to report against, so that there's consistency from an investor perspective in terms of what they're looking at, and consistency from a an issuer perspective or an asset manager perspective in terms of what they have to produce, and that the resources then are focused on doing the ESG investing and not in checking the box for many different regulators and the way they want things presented. So that's sort of in my narrow world of looking at the at rules and how they impact my clients. That's what I'd like to see.
Okay. Greg, in the future, what are your thoughts on the issue and what would you like to see?
Yeah, I think I expect to see even more focus on data analytics and reporting. Increasing the importance of having good data, storing it, protecting it, and using it to drive value creation. That's all going to be very important. I think the thing I'd like to see, we touched on it earlier, is at the board of directors level of companies, seeing metrics actually applied throughout the entire governance structure for this. So for example, the audit committee, the compensation committee, the nominating and governance committees, starting to inculcate ESG into how they think about governance, metrics, evaluation. I think you're going to see more of that over time.
Great. And Jennifer, why don't you bring us home and let us know what you're interested in seeing in the next 10 years.
So on the flip side of what Greg just mentioned, I'd say that workforce generational shifts will really likely demand an even greater focus on ESG. And so it will become a recruitment and retention challenge if a company doesn't take a stand one way or another. And so established companies won't necessarily be where the talent wants to work unless they shift in the way that younger generation is looking for them to shift. And talent may seek an employer whose values are much more aligned with their own. And on the flip side of that, I would say that younger investors also will likely want to invest in more socially responsible companies. Just seeing the dialogue, even amongst sort of the college and graduate school community, I've been hearing much more of that in terms of the people that we're recruiting. And so I think these are the things that will help drive change forward in addition to the governance piece.
What a great panel discussion. On behalf of the 2021 Permanent and Private Capital Summit, I would like to thank Jennifer, Anna Carolina, Greg, and Dechert's own Mikhaelle for taking the time to give us their thoughts on this most important topic, DE&I and ESG in the world of asset managers. Please enjoy the rest of the summit.